Now that you know about while loops, let's talk about another kind of loop, for loops. Here's a for loop I made to praise the most delicious kind of pizza, pineapple pizza. You might think, I liked while loops, why should I care about this new kind of loop? Well, soon you'll see that a for loop is a way to write simple kinds of while loops in a bit of a shorter way. So before we inspect this for loop, let's go ahead and look at a while loop, which will be a little bit more familiar, and then we'll get back to this for loop in a moment. So, just like you saw in intro to while loops, we start out with this variable y, and we write a message using that location y. We say that we want to keep going as long as y is less than 300, and change y by 40 each time. Now, just to reinforce each of these, which again should be pretty much reviewed, we can say that, well, pineapple pizza is the best is a really important message, so we probably want to be writing it more. So it should probably start higher, so we change that. It should probably go on for longer, so make that bigger. And it should probably be closer spaced together, don't you think? So that's a little bit better. Now let's see how we can change this while loop into a for loop. So I'm going to comment out this while loop just so you can see that a for loop really is doing what I'm saying it's going to do. And we'll say that we're going to create a for loop. I'll just create some space for us to fill in later. Something really important, kind of different for a for loop, is that it's not just one thing that goes in here. It's actually three things. And we tell the computer that by putting these semicolons to separate the three parts. So we'll have one part here, one part here, one part here, and then the inside of the loop just like we had before. So what goes in each of these parts? We can think of it as, we say for, we can say that we're going to have some sort of a start or initialization, then we'll have the semicolon, and then we're going to have some sort of instructions of how long to repeat, and then we're going to have some sort of change happening. So how does that correspond with this while loop? Well, really concretely, we can say that the start sets up this variable y here. So let's copy and paste that over to this first part of the for loop. And similarly, it appears first, so it's first. We can say that this middle part is telling us how long we should keep going for, and that goes in the middle. And then we say that the change happens at the end here, so we'll put that at the end of our for loop. And these three parts always have to occur in this order. In your for loop, you always have to start out by saying this is where this variable should start out as. Here it's 27. Then you need to say how long you want to keep going for. So repeat as long as it's less than 354. And then you need to put how you're going to be changing things. So here we're going to be changing by increasing y by 24. Then last, you just have to do whatever you wanted to do inside the for loop. So we'll go ahead and write that text there. And there we have it. Pineapple pizza is the best, and everybody will know. Okay, so now let's think a little bit more closely about what's happening with this for loop. If we wanted to change where it started, well, we just change the start here. If we wanted to change where it ended, we would change this endpoint. If we wanted to change the spacing, we would just change the increment number. And then we can also change, just like with a while loop, what value we have for x when we write our text. Great. One thing that can be confusing about a for loop is to remember what these semicolons do. You just need to remember that they always have to be there to separate the three parts. If we don't have them there, then we're going to get some weird error messages about our for loop, so whenever we see that, just double check that you have them. You also might get overenthusiastic and add an extra one at the end. But if you just remember that semicolons are only there to separate the three parts, then we can say that, well, this last semicolon isn't separating anything, it's just kind of trailing on there. We can get rid of it, because we don't need it. Now, I know you're probably getting a little bit tired of seeing these for loops getting converted into while loops and back, but let's just do it one more time, just so you can see that a for loop really is just another way to write a simple kind of a while loop, and you'll be really, really confident in understanding how to go from a for loop back into a while loop. Because you can do that, actually, with any kind of for loop, not just this one. First thing that we do is think about where to put this first value that we have inside of our for loop. Well, since it's just initializing this variable, remember that has to go outside, not inside the while loop. And it should go before as well, because we need to be using it during our while loop. Then you think about, well, where should this condition go? That's pretty easy. You probably remember that usually the stopping condition or the repeat until condition needs to go inside here. We're going to say that while y is less than 313, we'll just keep going. Finally, the change. Well, we always put the change at the end of the while loop in the loops that we've seen, so we should go and do that here. Now, We just need to move this text call inside, and there we have it. We can just comment out this for loop and see that we made the exact same thing happen once more. So, hopefully by now you can see that this new for loop isn't actually necessary. We could go through our entire programming lives writing loops that looked like this. But it is a little bit impressive how much more concise this for loop is, and how it makes it a little bit more clear once you're used to it, what's going on with how we're starting a variable, we're saying how long to keep going, and then we're changing that variable here. So, if you really hate for loops, you don't have to use them ever, but you should be used to seeing them, and if they're confusing, just remember that you can convert them right back into a while loop like this. And if you're feeling adventurous, try using a for loop in your new program, or going back to some of your old simple while loops and converting them into for loops if appropriate. As a final note, you cannot always convert a while loop into a for loop, only when they're in a really simple form like this, where it's really clear what variable you're starting out, how long it's going for, and how it's changing.